Hello, everyone, and welcome to Be Better Gamer Wrestling. I am Be Better Gamer. Champion. This is your place for Let's Plays of WWF No Mercy, WCW NW Revenge, and Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. It's been a while. It's been a long time if you are a returning subscriber. I apologize for the delay. I'm going to try to pick up the pace again. I say that quite a bit. I'm always on again, off again. But I am back, and I'm continuing with my WWF No Mercy Let's Play series, the Intercontinental Championship path. I am playing as Pat Patterson. Pat Patterson, this was supposed to be like a big surprise when I was doing my WWF No Mercy Let's Plays. I was on a roll. I was knocking out No Mercy Let's Plays every week. I mean, I was doing Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 Let's Plays every week, Revenge. And I gotta be honest, I got a little burnt out. It was very tiring to do that much every week. I did it for about a month and a half, and although my channel saw a lot of growth, it was very tiring. I fell behind on a lot of personal stuff, you know, housework and chores, painting my daughter's room and stuff like that. So I started playing other games and to try to like take a break from my Let's Plays and all the hard work I was putting into it. And then I kind of just fell off because life got in the way, because every weekend we had to go somewhere and do something, and every weeknight it always seemed like something was happening. So I'm going to try to find a nice balance going forward in terms of doing my Let's Plays, working on my YouTube channel. I'm almost at 500 subscribers. It's nuts. It's crazy. I'm super excited about that. I mean, my end of the year goal is 1,000 subscribers. But I have a lot of catching up to do, as well as going forward. I have a lot of plans. So I wanted to kind of just resume where I left off. And I'm really close to finishing the WWF No Mercy Intercontinental Championship path. And I wanted to do something different for the last two episodes, so I decided to play with Pat Patterson. Pat Patterson is not someone I played with at all, probably, when I first played WWF No Mercy. Obviously, they put Patterson and Brisco in this game. They're also in WWF WrestleMania 2000. They put them in, they were kind of like a comedy relief at this time. They were known as the Stooges to the corporation. You know, Vince McMahon, when he was in power, he had his stooges doing his bidding. And then even when Stephanie McMahon and Triple H, when they were the McMahon-Helmsley regime, even then they used the services of Patterson and Brisco. Patterson and Brisco did no real damage. They're like the putties in the Power Rangers, if you will. They're like the foot soldiers in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, a more modern reference in WWE about a year or so ago, J&J Security, you know, Jamie Noble, and, oh man, who's the other J&J Security? Oh my goodness, I can't believe I'm blanking on J&J Security. It was Jamie Noble, and I'm just gonna look it up. Josh? Oh wait, it's coming back to me. Joey Mercury. There we go. How could I forget Joey Mercury? I love Joey Mercury. J&J Security. They were kind of the new Patterson and Brisco, if you will. A lot of people drew comparisons to them because they were basically, when they came out, they were basically just going to get torn apart by whoever was trying to get to Seth Rollins. That's exactly what Brisco and Patterson were for, you know. If Stone Cold was trying to get to Vince McMahon, he couldn't quite get to him. So he just ended up taking out his frustration on Patterson and Brisco. You know, The Rock as well would do that. If you couldn't get to Triple H, you know, Patterson and Brisco would be in your way. And you know, sometimes they would also interfere in a lot of matches, cause a lot of people to lose. I have to lose this match. It's part of the path. It's part of the Intercontinental Championship path. So don't think just because I'm playing as Pat Patterson that, you know, I'm all of a sudden going to play terribly for this path. I guess I should say you have to lose the first match, and then you have to say no in this part. Godfather's going to come out. Godfather, recent Hall of Fame inductee, 2016, I should say, Hall of Fame class. Definitely saw that. I saw that entire Hall of Fame ceremony. It was the first time I ever watched a Hall of Fame ceremony. Like I mentioned earlier, I was painting. I was painting our big bathroom and watching the Hall of Fame ceremony. Very long-winded, but Godfather, he kept it short and sweet. You have to deny his services. His services, not with one of his ladies. WWE did very well in dancing around the fact. I mean, it was weird. They called him a pimp. All right, they acknowledged, yeah, Godfather's character was a pimp. Because I believe when they were inducting him, it was like, now the Hall of Fame has a pimp. And Godfather, when he went up, he would do his, his tagline. You know, now, once again, it's time to come aboard the... And, you know, the audience would say it. And, you know, they played some of the video, but they never basically said, you know, yeah, the hose. You know, the hose is what WWE called them. WWE called them the hose because he was a pimp and they were his hose. It was the Attitude Era. They could say these things. And now, obviously, they can't. I'm saying it because I'm referencing the Attitude Era. And you have to deny the Ho in this game. The Ho is an unlockable character. You go to SmackDown Mall, you pay $500,000, you can get the Ho. $500,000 is a lot of money in WWF No Mercy. It is not easy to get. But yeah, you know, Pat Patterson in this game, he's also a Hall of Famer, I should say. That's why I started talking about the Godfather. And also to let you guys know that I have been watching wrestling while I've been gone. I've been watching a lot of wrestling. A lot of great stuff is happening. But here you go. Look at this special. So I'm going to whip him to the corner. And boom. Double dragon screw. That's dangerous. That's dangerous right there. Shades of Keiji Muto from Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. So like I said in the beginning, I didn't really play much Pat Patterson growing up. I know it's a shocker. Because again, they were comedy acts. So I probably, honestly, I don't even really remember playing too much against Pat Patterson or Brisco, unless I had to face them in story mode. There's quite a few times you face them in story mode. I believe in, you know, the World Heavyweight Championship storyline path, one or twice you have to face them. I can't remember if I faced them even in the Intercontinental Championship path. I'm probably sure I did. But you do definitely face them a few times in a handicap match. I've never willingly decided, hey, I'm going to play as Pat Patterson. So I thought what would be kind of cool, instead of playing as him in his regular normal attire that he's given, I'd put his little old school attire, his old blue trunks and black boots, very standard. Everyone dressed very standard back then. Even though Pat Patterson was pretty boy Pat Patterson, he wore standard trunks and knee pads and boots, that's it, and then he wrestled. You know, back then, another reason why I wanted to focus on Pat Patterson, because he's one of the few legends, if you will, in this game. You know, I talk about Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 has this amazing roster, and one of the cool things about Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 is that it has all these legends. You know, even Andre the Giant's in the game. Andre the Giant's in this game, but he's also in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. They have the original Tiger Mask that you can unlock. You can unlock Jumbo Saruta, Abdullah the Butcher, Bruiser Brody, Terry Gordy, all these guys. Terry Gordy just recently inducted in the Hall of Fame as part of the Freebirds. He's an unlockable in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. And that's one of the great things about the roster of Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 is the legends. Nowadays, in the modern WWE 2K, you know, games, you have a lot of legends. You have a lot of legends you can unlock. I mean, they just released a few weeks ago, they just released the other part of the DLC, the Hall of Fame showcase from last year's Hall of Fame. Tatsumi Fujinami, Harlem Heat, Nash and Hall, Big Boss Man. You know, I did a Let's Play, WWE 2K16 Let's Play about the DLC. Big Boss Man was part of it, Kurt Hennig. You know, even within game, Ultimate Warrior, Stone Cold obviously is a legend now. He's not an active member of roster now, but to include him in your video game, you're including him because he's a legend. You know what I mean? You know, here in WWF No Mercy, Stone Cold was active roster. So if you look at the legends of No Mercy, it's very small. You got Patterson and Brisco, okay? You got Andre the Giant, Shawn Michaels technically, although he would come back a few years later, but by this time everyone thought he was done. Everyone thought he was retired. You know, and that was legit. Everyone did think Shawn Michaels was retired. Even Shawn Michaels himself talked about it, how he thought he was done. And yeah, I thought that was very interesting. You know, they don't really have unlockable legends. You know, who are the other some unlockable characters in this game? Jim Ross, Jerry the King Lawler, he's technically a legend, if you will, at this time, but he was still active commentary. So they were putting in faces in WWE, but realistically, Pat Patterson was one of the few legends. I mean, he was already inducted into the Hall of Fame by this time. Hall of Fame, he was inducted into the Hall of Fame in 1996. You know, back in the early days of the Hall of Fame, much different. And actually, it wouldn't be until 2004 when they would start up the Hall of Fame inductions again. So I thought it'd be cool. I should have said this at the beginning. Pat Patterson was the very first Intercontinental Champion. That's another main reason why I chose to play as Pat Patterson, with his very generic moveset, as you can see as you're watching. Right now I'm facing Mark Henry, super heavyweight, so a lot of body slams and super back drops, because when you're playing a super heavyweight, that's what you gotta do. The Roddy Piper taunt, that's what I call it, the Roddy Piper taunt, because that's what Roddy Piper did in WCW NW Revenge. Double Dragon Screw once again. But this is a different Double Dragon Screw. This is not the Double Dragon Screw that Keiji Muto does in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, I believe. Because I think there's two variations. Because there's this one where he gives that taunt. Although I don't remember. I don't think Keiji Muto. I play as Keiji Muto all the time. You think I should know this by now. If he does the stupid taunt while he's doing the Dragon Screw, going for the figure four. You know, when I was playing as Pat Patterson, I had to look up, because again, I didn't watch a lot of old Pat Patterson stuff. I had to look up some stuff, some videos, and I was like, well, what was his finisher? Did he finish with a Double Dragon Screw? Did he finish with a figure four? He did use a figure four. He did use it in some of the clips I saw. He did put it on. But everyone used the figure four back then. I mean, it's become synonymous with Ric Flair. But honestly, like, the figure four, everyone used that. But what if his finishing moves was like an atomic drop? Think about that. That's how much wrestling has changed. One of his moves was an atomic drop. That was his finisher. Sleeper hold, he won matches with. But again, that was a move. A lot of people won sleeper hold. You know, a lot of people won matches with a sleeper hold. Here we go. Pat Patterson versus Mae Young. Isn't this funny? I did not plan this. I did not know that I was going to be fighting Mae Young in the Intercontinental Championship. It's also symbolic, because look where we're fighting at right now. We're at the King of the Ring. We're at the King of the Ring. I just fought Mark Henry. Now I'm fighting Mae Young. You got to believe, like, this is probably because of the Mark Henry-Mae Young storyline. I don't know. That's what I'm thinking. Maybe they put that in here. It's very interesting that they put this in here as part of a championship title path for the Intercontinental Championship. But it's working out perfectly. I'm facing Mae Young at the King of the Ring, obviously in the year 2000. You know, WWF No Mercy came out at the end of 2000, November of 2000. King of the Ring 2000, the infamous evening gown match between Pat Patterson and Gerald Brisco. Pat Patterson at the time was the hardcore champion. He beat Gerald Brisco for the hardcore championship under the 24-hour rule. Gerald Brisco stole the championship in a way from Crash Holly. And they had this evening gown match. Why not? Pat Patterson apparently was furious to be part of the match. He did not want to do it. He did not want to do the evening gown match. And Brisco didn't want to do it either. But Vince McMahon talked them into it. Said it'd be great. It'd be great, kid. Come on, you go out there. Evening gown match. It'd be hilarious. That's my Vince McMahon. I'm working on it. And they had this match. And it's awful. It's an awful match. It's a silly match. It's not one of those matches that we're looking to go out there and get a 5-star rating. You know what I mean? It's just one of those to kill time matches, but you know, it's people remember it. People remember the evening gown match between old ass Pat Patterson and old ass Gerald Brisco. Makes you think if they would ever do something like that today. JJ Security evening gown match. Who knows? but yeah, I just think it's funny that I end up facing Mae Young for this evening gown match. I think I'm supposed to beat her in 3 minutes. I don't know if I do. I can't remember. I recorded this quite a while ago. So rewatching this footage is going to be interesting to see exactly. But I do remember having fun. I do remember this championship path being kind of epic with Pat Patterson. This was around the time when I was trying to shorten my Let's Play videos, shorten the gameplay, but the championship path was so long. So even though I do my best to try to skip through the cutscenes and to skip through everything, the matches turned out to be much longer than I planned them to be. And that's partly because, I don't know, I don't want to blame Pat Patterson, but I'm going to kind of blame Pat Patterson. His moveset is so generic. It's so basic. And it's not, I don't know, there's just something, like, I get it, all right, like, I get it. Like, they didn't do flashy stuff. They didn't do crazy stuff back then. But, like, wrestling was so simple back then. And when you try to translate that to the game, it's very hard, especially when you want to create an older character. So let's say you want to create, you know, Pat Patterson in WWE 2K16, he's going to have the most generic moveset on the face of the planet. You know what I mean? He's going to have the back body drop and the body slam and, you know, maybe a drop toe hold, maybe a sleeper hold. You know what I mean? Like, he's gonna be so basic to play as. And I don't know, I guess that's kind of the appeal with these legends when you play these legend characters in the game. But I don't know, it's always disappointing when I go for like a strong grapple and it's just like a headlock takedown. It's like, really? Like, come on, that's an E rating, guys. Like, but then again, you know, Pat Patterson's not gonna be doing hurricanranas and, you know, power bombs and stuff like that. So whatever, you know, I get it. But it's also difficult to play as a character like that who doesn't have, at least for me it is, because, you know, when I play these games, I like to play them in a way where sort of like I'm putting on a real match. You know what I mean? Like, and these guys, Pat Patterson, if you watch old clips of Pat Patterson, he's definitely entertaining to watch. Because it's different watching wrestling than playing a wrestling video game. And when you watch old Pat Patterson, you don't mind if he's doing the most basic of basic moves, because half the storytelling in wrestling is what you're doing in the ring, how you work in the audience, how you yourself are selling, and how much impact you're giving to those moves. So you can get away with doing only a few minimal moves. I mean, look at even in the modern era, or even in the Attitude era, there was a lot of guys who did the most basic of basic stuff, and fans still love to see them wrestle because there were other aspects of their matches that were very entertaining. It doesn't really translate well to a wrestling video game, at least these wrestling video games. So when you have like the basic of basic moves, like, oh, there's a double underhook suplex, that's probably the most spectacular thing Patterson does, is a double underhook suplex, the running drop kick. But it's very simple, like, look at that cradle pin, like, I don't want to go for a cradle pin, like, you know what I mean, like, it's the worst possible time to try to do a cradle pin, especially in a tag team match. Just throwing out random pins doesn't help, because it's gonna get Road Dogg back into the ring. It's just gonna prolong the match. He doesn't have a lot of moves that can help close a match. I mean, just the double dragon screw itself. The double dragon screw is it's a cool move, and it sets up the figure four. But that's the thing. That's a lot of setup for that figure four. And there's not really anything else in Patterson's moveset that can help me set up that figure four. So I kind of have to do, you know, very generic moves to try to weaken the leg, but it's really that double dragon screws is gonna get me to really put someone away for the figure four. I know I might be going a little bit too deep about this, about the moveset of Pat Patterson, but it was kind of difficult. It was like, how do I put on an entertaining match playing with someone with a very generic moveset, especially someone like Pat Patterson? People are probably not gonna be used to seeing Pat Patterson, you know, take him seriously. Pat Patterson, the wrestler, Pat Patterson, the first Intercontinental Champion, even though he won it in a fake tournament. I guess I should mention that also. So Pat Patterson, he was the first Intercontinental Champion, and he apparently won it at a tournament, and this was totally the storyline they used when they introduced the Intercontinental Championship, one of the most prestigious titles in all of wrestling for the longest time. Not really most, you know, let's be honest. Not anymore, but, you know, that's a whole nother story. And I've probably talked about that a bunch on this, on these Let's Play episodes. And I'll probably talk about it again. But when they first introduced the Intercontinental Championship, Pat Patterson claimed he was the Intercontinental Champion by winning a tournament in Brazil. That tournament actually never took place, it would later be revealed. Like realistically, it never took place. It wasn't like Pat Patterson was making it up. It was like, WWE is like, all right, we got a new championship. Let's give it to Pat Patterson. And Pat Patterson's like, whoa, but who did I beat? It's like, you beat someone in a tournament in Brazil. We'll say that. We'll go with that. It's the internet's not around. They don't have Twitter. They don't have Facebook. No one can really confirm this. Go. And people bought it. Because back then, you know, we're talking, when was this belt created? You're talking about 1979, the Intercontinental Championship was introduced. We didn't have Facebook. We didn't have Twitter, YouTube, obviously internet. You know, we didn't have a lot of stuff. So people couldn't really fact check that. When someone guy came in and say, I'm the Intercontinental Champion, I won it in Brazil, the fans of wrestling at the time would just buy it. They would just, no one was going to look up on their phone. Did that really happen a week ago? Was he really in Brazil? I don't remember reading about some tournament in Brazil on WWE.com. So there was no way to verify that. Ah, the glories of wrestling before the reality era, as Triple H calls it. But yeah, he held it for 233 days, and he eventually lost it to Ken Patera at a house show in New York City. And so probably at MSG. I'm going to say MSG, even though I don't know if it was actually at MSG. But it was in New York, New York, so where else could it have been? Because WWE ran New York City a lot around then, my own stopping grounds. So here we go. I'm kind of moving, right? It kind of feels like I'm moving through this championship path. I'm already up to Chapter 6. The Intercontinental Championship, like I always said, is the longest championship path. Well, it's the second longest, technically. Well, I don't know. It's debatable. It's because it's like it has the most blocks, right? I always confuse this. It has 57 blocks. And how much does the Hardcore Championship have? Hardcore has 57. So it's one block more than the Hardcore Championship. The Tag Team Championship has 56 blocks as well. Let's just say the Intercontinental Championship is definitely the longest. So Chapter 6, but, you know, I still have a few more matches to go. Is it 10 matches total? Let me count real quick. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9, all right, 9 matches you got to do. 9 chapters you got to do. So where is the rest of this time devoted to? Well, you'll see. You'll see where I get caught up on when I'm playing as Pat Patterson. Here I go, playing against the Dudley Boys. Did the Dudleys ever put Patterson through a table? I'm sure they did, right? The Dudleys probably put them through the table. But Pat Patterson, so, you know, going old school, talking about Intercontinental Championship. Another thing that's very interesting about Pat Patterson. So he was the first Intercontinental Champion. He lost it to Ken Patera at a house show. On WWE Network, there's no footage of Pat Patterson with the Intercontinental Championship. You could find some stuff if you go on YouTube and things like that. There are definitely videos out there, but there's not really much of anything on the network, and which is kind of surprising because you think they would have stuff with Pat Patterson wrestling as the Intercontinental Champion, because they do have some of those old MSG house shows. But there is, you guys should check out if you got the time. I would definitely recommend checking out Pat Patterson versus Sergeant Slaughter. It's on the WWE Network. Old MSG house show. Very cool. Very cool to see Pat Patterson and Slaughter. Pat Patterson is just Pat Patterson as a babyface, Slaughter as the heel. Old school Sergeant Slaughter as a heel, you know, before Hogan and everything. Very different Sergeant Slaughter. Very great to see. And again, basic wrestling, you know, I call it basic now. Back then it wasn't basic, you know, that was wrestling. But, you know, wrestling what we know of today, oh man, I get put through the table. I think I was supposed to put Bubba through the table, because this was a table match. Does this count I don't remember. I think this does count. Even though I went through the table, it still counts. So there you go, if you needed the answer to that question. So yeah, another thing that fascinated me about Pat Patterson that I'm going to be honest, I didn't really know about this until maybe a few years ago. I guess I just never found out about it. But apparently it was very widely known that Pat Patterson was openly gay. And when I found that out, I was blown away. I was like, really? Like, WWE never acknowledged it. But apparently it was always widely known. And just for some reason, me, someone who feels like, you know, who felt like they knew everything there is to know about every wrestling and everyone, and all these like secrets and hidden truths and, you know, what really went on, this and that. I never knew Pat Patterson was gay, and that blew my mind because WWE, they never really embraced, you know, openly gay wrestlers, and they never really had an openly gay wrestler, you know, someone who's marketed openly gay. And especially when Goldust was introduced, they did a very poor job of, you know, making someone who was, you know, gay feel okay, feel that that was right. Obviously, Goldust, when he came out, everyone viewed him as weird. And Jerry the King Lawler, I'm talking about, like, you know, original Goldust. Like, the whole gimmick about him was he was this very sexually mysterious being, and that was a negative. That was a heel. You have to boo him because he's weird, because he might be gay. And even Jerry Lawler drops the F-bomb on him and calls him queer and calls him all these things, and it was seen as a negative. And Jerry Lawler was totally okay on screen saying these things to Goldust. And again, very different time. But I remember watching that as a kid. I was like, this doesn't feel right. This doesn't feel cool. Like, it's okay. I was, even at me as a kid, I was like, it's okay to be gay wrestling. Why I gotta be like that? And if you look back in the past, there was always characters who walked that fine line. And if they walked that fine line of maybe being gay or, you know, more feminine, it was always seen as a negative, as them being a heel. Even early WWF had some of those characters. You know, WCW, they had Lodi and Lenny Lane. Lenny Lane especially, you know, when he became TV title champion, they stripped, or no, Cruiserweight champion, I believe, one of the titles, they stripped him of the championship because the executives at TBS didn't want a person who was portraying an openly gay character to actually have a championship. And, you know, there's a lot of controversy surrounding it, and WCW immediately, you know, backpedaled from the idea. So when I found out that Pat Patterson was gay and he had so much involvement with WWE, you know, that kind of warmed my heart a little bit. It also made me look at that evening gown match in a totally different light. But take that as you will. I mean, Pat Patterson, he was definitely involved with it. So, you know, who knows? He was comfortable with it. But, you know, it's the kind of thing where, you know, we live in society now where, you know, it is being more and more widely accepted, thankfully, about, you know, people being gay, marrying whoever the hell they want. No big deal. Like, what's the big deal? I don't see the big deal. Like, just do it. If you're happy to be with someone that you can say that you love them enough that you want to spend their life with them, more power to you, because finding someone to love, whether it be someone of your sex or the opposite sex, is not an easy thing to do in this lifetime. So we should be happy when people are finding love, as opposed to being negative if it just so happens, oh, but you're a dude, you shouldn't love, like, shut up, you know, like, that's, but, you know, I think one of the big drawbacks when it comes to sports is how very macho everything is, very, you know, being open gay has only been kind of a recent thing in sports, very, you know, there's very few openly gay athletes, and they've definitely been cheered and, you know, recognized for their bravery, for coming out, especially in you know, sports and things that are necessarily tend to be kind of anti-gay. And there is some truth to that, but at the end of the day, I think that realistically, there's a lot of guys involved in sports, in football, in baseball, in wrestling, that if they found out one of their teammates that were gay, they'd be like, well, what's the big deal? He's my buddy. You know, he's at the end of the day, he's my buddy, he's my teammate. I don't care who he goes home with that night. You know, so I think that was the case with Pat Patterson. Pat Patterson actually talked about it quite a bit in an episode of JR's podcast. And it's very enlightening. It was very interesting. You know, I did some research and I listened to that episode with Pat Patterson and Jim Ross. And he talked a lot about him coming from Quebec. I mean, he was an outsider in two ways if you look at it. Because he was an outsider, one, because he was coming from Canada. He didn't know English. You know, and that's a big barrier in itself, only speaking French, you know, coming from Quebec, coming from Montreal. So having to learn how to wrestle, but then also having to learn how to wrestle and you're the only guy who speaks French in an all English locker room was very tough. So he had to do that. And then also coming out and being openly gay, not just coming out and being openly gay in wrestling, but coming out and being openly gay in the 60s, okay? In the 60s, in the 70s. Everyone who knew Pat Patterson, everyone who worked with Pat, the fans didn't know. I mean, I'm sure some fans knew, because even back then, word got around to the fans and stuff like that. But it wasn't ever actually publicized, oh, here's Pat Patterson, our gay wrestler, our gay superstar, you know? But all the people behind the scenes knew it, all the wrestlers knew it. And Pat Patterson, for a long time, he had a partner that was very well known with all his wrestling friends and with the companies he worked with and stuff like that. So that just, you know, I'm sure he faced some adversity, but Pat Patterson talked about in the podcast that it never really came up. No one ever really bothered him about it. And that's very cool to hear. You know, in wrestling today, you have, oh my goodness, now I'm blanking on his name. Primetime players. It is Darren Young and Titus O'Neil. So Darren Young recently came out, you know, on social media that he was gay, and I believe WWE expounded upon that a bit and talked about it a bit, but then they just kind of just left it. And honestly, I feel like that's how it should be. You know what I mean? Like, it's kind of... wrestling, when I look at wrestling, yes, wrestling, you know, like any other art form, because wrestling is an art form, some of the best storylines in wrestling touch on realistic events. So sometimes, yes, you do need characters who kind of reflect what's going on in society. But you don't have to do that all the time. And you also don't have to revert to certain stereotypes or gender types because, A, they keep expanding on a negative connotation to whatever that stereotype or that gender role is that you're putting in a negative, you know, viewpoint. You're making your audience keep thinking it's negative, and that's not wrong. That's not cool. I mean, that's not right. That's not cool. But also, it just feels very outdated, very antiquated. And if you want to connect to a modern audience, you have to kind of fall in line with a little bit more modern beliefs. I like to believe that a lot of people today are cool with people being gay. I mean, you should be, honestly. If you don't, you know, try to work that out for yourself. But it's not that bad. You know, get over it. You know, there's much more terrible things to worry about than if someone you know happens to be gay. Like, it's okay. It's not a big deal. So I like to believe that a lot of the modern audience who watches wrestling, who watches a lot of stuff, they're kind of cool and comfortable with it. But you don't need it thrown in your face either. You don't need it thrown in your face. You don't need to be told who's gay and who's not. Like, honestly, that's their life. That's their, you know, that's what they do in their own personal life should be separated from their characters on screen unless they choose to bring that in. You know, Darren Young, I think when he came out, he did it more so for himself. He did it more so for maybe people he felt like who are in his position as an athlete and they are afraid to come out. He showed, hey, look, I'm successful. I'm working for a major company. I'm gay. It's okay. Everyone loves me here. We're all cool. And, you know, to give power to the people who probably are too afraid to still come out or don't feel like they can come out. And to know that Pat Patterson was doing that, you know, 40 years before, that's incredible. That's really incredible. It makes me want to go read his book. I believe he has a book. At least he said, I think he said he was going to write a book. Did he write a book? He did write a book. I'm going to look it up. Pat Patterson book. And... oh, yeah. It's called Accepted. So, yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if he... is that real? That's not real. That might not be real. Oh, yeah, it is. It is real. Accepted. Pat Patterson, how the first gay superstar changed WWE. There you go. Just putting it all out there. How awesome is that? You know, it made me look at Pat Patterson in a whole different light. Because, like I said, I found out about it probably a few years ago. But didn't really dive too deeply into that. Like, how is that possible? Like, the shit he must have put up with. And here he is saying, nah, man, everyone was cool with it. It warmed my heart a bit. You know, it really did. Because I always feel... I definitely saw it. I definitely saw it growing up. I remember I was thinking about trying out for my high school football team. And I was talking to a friend of mine who had quit the high school football team. And I was like, why'd you quit? And he was like, because I'm gay. And I was like, so? What does that mean? He's like, well, you know, people would, they would haze me a lot. They would tease me. They would hit me harder in practice. They would call me, you know, they would say all these names to him. And I looked at him and I was like, they really did that to you? He's like, yeah, they did. And here's this like 6'2", you know, very sweet, you know, nice guy. But, you know, he wanted to play football. He's 6'2". You know, he could definitely run and catch the ball. I used to play... you know, just regular pickup games out on the lawn with him and a few of my other buddies. And I'm like, just because, you know, he was gay, you know, they didn't want him on the football team. And that didn't sit well with me. I'm not gay. I mean, I've never had interest in men. But, like, just knowing that the fact that here's a group of people that are going to hate on you for something that you've chosen, you know, something that you are. That you can't deny in your life, like that was really messed up to me. And again, it's that whole, and who knows, maybe a lot of the kids were doing it because they felt pressured by the other kids. It's high school. That's the kind of stuff happens all the time, but especially to happen, you know, on a sports team, you know, it left a bad taste in my mouth. I'm like, man, I hope not all sports teams are like this, or they're all gonna be like, hey, come on, let's go beat up on the gay kid. Like, that's messed up. And I'm sure not all sports teams are like that. And, you know, but, you know, it, the fact that you hear those stories and you can only assume the worst, and I don't want to assume the worst. So hearing about Pat Patterson's success and all his, you know, great things he was able to accomplish, you know, and another thing too, another interesting thing about Pat Patterson that I didn't know about. So that longtime partner he had actually passed away the night of the Hell in a Cell match with Mankind and Undertaker. And it was a really big blow to the locker room, because again, a lot of people very close to Pat Patterson, they were very close to his partner. But then you had the double effect of, we might lose Mick Foley tonight because he's getting thrown off the Hell in a Cell. There's like a movie in this, man. There's like a movie in this, man. I always talk about how, like, well, at least I tell my friend, like, there should be this great, like, gritty TV show about wrestling. You know, like, imagine watching, like, they should go from, like every season should be, like, half a decade. You know, like, you do the 60s, season 1 and 2, season 3 and 4, you do the 70s, you know, 5 and 6, you do the 80s, and then maybe 90, and you could keep going that way. Every season, you can do half a decade. And all the gritty, real life stuff that they don't talk about, that's just so fascinating. I mean, here's a night that's pretty much changing the world of wrestling, and Pat Patterson, unfortunately, is probably going through one of the worst nights of his life. And you know, to lose someone that you've been involved with for 40 years, that's nuts. That's crazy. You know, I'm married. I've been together with my, you know, wife. We've been together for 10 years. Man, if I were to lose her tomorrow, like, that would be the worst thing to ever happen to me. But if that were to happen 40 years from now, it would be 30 years worse. You know what I mean? It'd be so much more tragic. So I can't even begin to put myself in that position. But everyone's watching Mick Foley. You know, a lot of people have talked about this. A lot of people have talked about Mick Foley when they were watching him. They all thought he was dead. You know, JR has talked about it. Even in his last podcast, he talked about it again because, you know, we just had the Shane McMahon Undertaker Hell in a Cell match. So, of course, everyone was talking about the Undertaker Mankind Hell in a Cell match. And he's talking about it with Jim Cornette. And he's saying, everything I said was ad-lib, was on the spot, coming from the gut. I literally thought, you know, I was watching something terrible and tragic, and Mick Foley was gonna be able to get up again, you know, when he got first thrown. And go back and watch it again if you've never watched that first Hell in a Cell. I mean, who hasn't watched it by now? But, you know, WWE Network, go watch it, it's there. Seeing Mankind get thrown off the way he did from that Hell in a Cell, and then to see him the way he fell, which was, I think, in my opinion, was worse, when he fell through the Hell in a Cell, which happened right after him getting thrown off, you can't help but think he died. Like, I mean, this is, you look at Shane McMahon's bump, and I'm not taking anything away from Shane McMahon's bump. Shane McMahon jumping off the top of Hell in a Cell. Yeah, I mean, if I was in front of a crowd of 100,000 people on the biggest night of wrestling, yeah, maybe, probably I'll do it. Maybe. I don't know. I can't confidently say, yeah, totally I'll do it, because that's a scary thought. But it definitely did look like he was a little bit more protected, as one can be jumping off from the top of a, whatever, 30-foot it was, I think. Hell, you know, steel cage, and only giving yourself a margin of a few feet to hit your landing. You know, you're definitely not going to walk away without a scratch, and he definitely looked pretty banged up from the moment of impact, whether that was just him selling it or just him not having to, because he's like, I just threw myself off a cage onto a table, this hurt. But it definitely looked like that table had some extra support in it. When they kept showing replays, and this was definitely a pre-planned spot. You know, I think that was a lot of the appeal of Shane McMahon, Undertaker, Hell in a Cell, WrestleMania. A lot of the appeal was, he's jumping off the cage, you know? Like, I think we all knew it, like, going into it. And, you know, it was, you couldn't ask for a more perfect reaction when Shane McMahon, first the opening of the Hell in a Cell, got a big pop. It was like, all right, we're going there. It was just pretty much confirming that they were going there. And then that moment where Shane is leaning against the cage and he just glances up. He just glances up, and the whole arena lost it, because we all knew what was gonna happen. Shane knew it, we knew it, everyone knew it, and that was the difference between this spot and when Mankind and Undertaker did it, is that no one knew about it. Even Mankind himself said, I knew we were gonna start the match at the top of the cage, didn't really know what was gonna happen after that. And you know, he really did take a leap of faith. Shane's leap of faith, like much of Shane's leaps of faith, you could tell he was kind of protected. But again, as protected as you can be from jumping off the top of the cage. So I can't really take anything from that, because, you know, you tell me to do something like that and I'd probably say, you know, maybe get someone else for this one. Like, you know, and he had his kids in the front. Oh my goodness. The guts he had. The guts. He crossed himself. Like, you knew it was coming the whole time. You knew it was coming. I remember watching it. And I'm just thinking, like, he's crossing himself, standing on top of this cage, about to jump off. Like, don't cross yourself. Like, that like, just made me so scared. Even though, again, like, this is something they've been probably preparing for. But, yeah, so, anyway, why did I start talking about the Hell in a Cell? because Pat Patterson and his... Okay, now I remember. Sometimes I get off on my tangents, and I don't remember why I got off my tangents. But I guess it makes sense, talking about all that stuff. And I guess I should sprinkle in some WrestleMania talk here and there, because I've been gone so long. Here I am, trying to work the leg. Steve Blackman, still trying to put... These matches... Again, these matches are going on longer and longer because I'm trying to specifically put these guys away in a certain way with Pat Patterson, who has the generic wrestler moveset. Don't worry, I won't be doing a Brisco run unless you guys want me to do a Brisco run. Maybe you guys want me to do a Brisco and Pat Patterson run. You let me know, because, hey, I'll do it for you guys if you want me to. If you want to see a Brisco Hardcore Championship run or Patterson and Brisco Tag Team Championship run, I'll do it. I don't know if I'll do Let's Play commentary for it, but I'll do it. So another thing I want to talk about, too, about Pat Patterson, if you don't already know, is that he invented the Royal Rumble. Pretty cool, huh? That's it. I just wanted to throw that out there. I mean, what else can you say about that? Here's Pat Patterson. He came up with the idea for the Royal Rumble, and the winner's going to face the champion. Like, he was very influential. I think that's the thing, the fascinating thing about Pat Patterson. Here he is, first Intercontinental Champion, but here's a guy who... You know, his success in the ring is probably far more outweighed than his success outside of the ring. It's not just his success with WWE and how instrumental he's been with a lot of the backstage stuff, the creative, mentoring wrestlers. He was an agent for a very long time in terms of helping come up with finishes of matches, come up with finishes of story angles, and this like that. Created the Royal Rumble, and I'm sure he created a whole bunch of other match types. But his personal success, if you will, being an openly gay wrestler, and I'm sure there's a lot of other wrestlers who are openly gay that we, the public, probably still don't know about. But maybe if it wasn't for a guy like Pat Patterson to come in there, they probably wouldn't have the confidence to come out and be that. But yeah, I would love to see that in a TV show. There's a book out called, what is it called? Blood Red Dollar Green? Am I making that up? Blood Red Dollar Green. Yeah, Blood Red Turns Dollar Green. It's a book by an Irish playwright, and it's about wrestling. And I so want to read it. So bad. Right? Is that? Yeah. It's about wrestling, I think. That's the one I'm thinking about? Yeah, pro wrestling. And I hear really great things about it. And that kind of book, the way, you know, what I hear about it, you know, is kind of like the idea I have for like a TV show. You know, really cool behind the scenes look. Because I think some of these guys, they go through stuff behind the scenes that in some ways, in a lot of ways, not only help flesh out the story that's happening on screen, but adds like a whole nother layer of drama and context that we'll never know about. And I would love to see some of it, you know, I would love to see some of that reality taken into a fictional setting like a TV show or something like that. You could definitely do a long term. Maybe I'll write my play one day. I have this idea for a play built around wrestling. Maybe I'll do that one day too. Get that out in the limelight. But here I go. So this is where... So the Let's Play has been going on pretty long because the matches have been taking on forever. But this is where it gets epic. Test, Pat Patterson, Intercontinental Championship, Steel Cage Match. And if I had the ability to call this match blow for blow, I would, but I won't. But this match, oh my goodness, this match takes a long time. I don't know what it was with this run. This run, again, I don't know if it was because I'm playing with Pat Patterson pretty much for the first time, you know, I had a few warm-up exhibition matches. Every time before I do a Let's Play, I usually play one or two matches. Especially in this case, I had to play a match to win the Intercontinental Championship with Pat Patterson before I was able to go down the championship path with Pat Patterson. But you know, just to refamiliarize myself with some wrestlers that maybe I haven't really touched in a long time. You know, some wrestlers I know exactly what they do. Benoit, Guerrero, you know, Kurt Angle, you know, guys I always usually played as. But with someone like Pat Patterson, I definitely needed a few warm-ups. And I did some warm-ups and I was like, all right, yeah, his moveset's pretty generic. But you know what? I'll still be able to burn through this. And man, was I wrong. This championship path took a hell of a long time. And it didn't help that I got to the second-to-last match, which was a cage match. And the struggle of... This is where I ran into the problem of Pat Patterson's moveset backfiring on me. Because here I go. So I've talked about in the past how in the cage matches, the computer is way overpowered. The computer can climb the cage insanely fast, no matter what they do, no matter what level their spirit meter is at. And then I also, that's what it was. I had to make him bleed. Oh my goodness. Making someone bleed in the cage match, it can either happen in the first few minutes or it can take forever like in this one. And that's one of the most frustrating things. So to kind of, you know, paint around the floor without painting myself into a corner while I'm trying to set up tests to get a bloody face so that I can climb the cage and get out of there when I have my next special. I know that at some point he's going to start getting a comeback special. And I've talked about a comeback special in the past. Basically, comeback special is when the computer's special meter, or your meter, it could happen to you too, starts growing at like 2 times the speed for every little thing. Every little thing boosts the meter, and then when you do submission holds, your meter climbs up. So right around here is when Tess's comeback special should activate if I start letting him get just a little bit of momentum, because he's already lived through 2 specials. And usually after the computer has lived through 2 specials in WWF No Mercy, that is prime time for the comeback special, if you give him an edge. Right now I'm pretty much staying dominant. I'm kind of rolling the dice with all these cage slams, honestly, because he can counter it at any time. But I'm trying to get that bloody face going. And I'm also trying to set up C-Test's leg. If he does get that comeback special going, if I'm able to... There's that counter. There's that comeback special. There it is. Look at his meter go. It's going to jump right to orange. Right there. Boom. Oh, it's getting there. Look, that little stomp. Those stomps usually don't... In WWF No Mercy, those stomps don't raise your meter. That's how you know he has a comeback special, because now his meter's raising for the little stomp. But see, there I go. I lock in the figure four. His leg has been worked on because of all the double dragon screws, and he doesn't tap out, which scares me a little bit, I'm not gonna lie. But basically what you want to do is submission moves are key here, because you can cause them to tap within the cage and bring their meter back down. Because again, if Tess were to start climbing right now in his meter, even though it's orange, he would go over the cage. If I were to climb right now in orange, I would not go over the cage. And that's one of the frustrating things about doing a cage match, especially where you got to get them to bleed, because getting them to bleed is not always guaranteed. And again, Pat Patterson doesn't have any moves really that can cause someone to bleed, so I have to bank on either slamming their face into the cage. And look how fast he got back to the orange. That's insane he got so back to orange so quickly. That doesn't even make sense. This is really dangerous territory now, because now I've taken a few moves, so he's able to keep me down a little bit longer. I gotta be very careful here. This is very tough. But basically, trying to make him bleed in the cage match, you're gonna want to slam their head against the cage, or you're gonna want to slam their face into the turnbuckle. And you basically just gotta wait. You just gotta wait and see. Sometimes I've played cage matches where the first, you know, couple of times I slam their head into the cage, they bust right open. you know, the blood comes out, and I'm like, great. And then I hit that special meter, do my move, and then I climb out the cage. But then you have cases like this where, here we go, we're already 6 minutes into the match, 6 minutes no mercy time, and he is still not into it. He is countering moves. He is, you know, his meter just won't stay down no matter how many times I make him tap. And it's very frustrating. It's very, and you gotta play it smart. And that's, you know, that's what I love about this game too, because, all right, you know, I've always said WWF No Mercy, the AI is not as challenging as Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. WCW NW Revenge is more challenging too, but only because the computer is a little bit more against you in that game. Definitely the computer plays a lot more in its favor in that game. But No Mercy, there's very few places where I feel like I'm challenged, but this is a challenge in its own way. It's not the most fun challenge. You know, there's a difference between a fun challenge that's difficult but you're having fun, and a challenge that's difficult and you just want it to be over. You just want to get through it. This is that kind of challenge. You just want to get through it. I want to get over it because I've already invested so much time, not only in this run through, but I've invested so much time into this match that I don't want it to end the way I fear it's going to end, which is Tess is going to not bleed. And then he's just going to climb the cage really quickly after he does like a big slam. I managed to avoid him getting his first special, but now I got to manage to avoid him climbing the cage, even with that gimp leg. Come on, Tess. What a battle. Tess, Pat Patterson for the Intercontinental Championship. This is nuts. Doing my Kamala taunts. I don't know why they gave Pat Patterson the Kamala taunt. But here I go. Again, trying to set up, just getting the blood. I'm getting desperate. I'm just going for all those moves. He keeps countering it, which doesn't help. It really doesn't help. It's very frustrating. Man, I wish that haymaker could bust him open. I wasn't too sure if the haymaker could bust him open, which is why I probably didn't throw it out as much. Still not sure. Didn't go back and check. You know, and it's weird. And it's like, I don't really know. I can't really tell you what busts them open faster, if by hitting them in the cage or hitting them in a turnbuckle. I think in one of my other Let's Plays, I was doing a cage match where I had to make the opponent bleed, and I was like just slamming them headfirst into the steel cage over and over again. And then after about like 5 minutes, I was like, all right, let me switch over to the turnbuckle. And I slammed them into the turnbuckle like 2 times and they bust open. And it's just, I don't know, I want to say it's random, but then also, you know, you do your stats when you create your wrestler, and sometimes the there's the option that they bleed rarely. I didn't check to see before I recorded this. I didn't check to see what Tess's parameter was, because again, I didn't know that I was going to be facing Tess in a steel cage match where I got to make him bleed. Now I'm just getting angry, so I'm doing his finishers. I'm doing Tess's pump handle slam. Can't counter me where I got my special. That's a fact. Is it? I don't know if that's a fact. Should be. Boom. Trying to bust him open still. So yeah, so like, you know, I like to rely on the cage because it's quick. You don't have to drag him. You know, waste time dragging him to the turnbuckle. See how long that takes. Dragging him to the turnbuckle. It's just much faster to get them to the cage from no matter where you are. You know, I like to think that the longer you run towards the cage, the more likely it is you'll bust them open. As you know, when they fall backwards like that, I want to say that's a much stronger cage slam than if you throw them to the cage and they land on all fours. That usually means you're very close to the cage. You know, I don't know if any of that actually works. That's just my own little like methods that I like to think work. Bam, stealing his special again because I'm just so frustrated. But here's the problem too. So you get him to bleed, right? Let's say I get him to bleed with the next, you know, hit, right? What is it? Turnbuckle, boom. Still no blood. But I get him to bleed, and now I have to get him to bleed, and then I have to climb the cage. So I still have to get my special meter up, which is another part of the challenge of these matches. Perfect scenario. You get him to bleed right before you activate your special, and then you can just hit your special and get out of there. You don't have to waste any more time. I don't know if the punching helps with the bleeding. You know, I just do it sometimes because I'm like, well, they can't tap out of it, but, you know, hopefully it'll make him bleed. You know, I don't know if that, now he's grabbing his head. So maybe I did weaken his head enough so that it's easier for him to bleed. But again, I've made people bleed in the past without having to work their head, or they're not grabbing their head in pain. So I can't really tell you the science and the mechanics of how blood works. You know, if the parameters have a lot to do with it, or if it really is random. I always honestly felt blood in all of the AKI wrestling games were random. It was never guaranteed. There were moves obviously that caused blood and some didn't, but you know, I'm sure if you were to do a match where, let's say you do a match and you slam someone's head into the turnbuckle 10 times, I bet you every time you did that match, it'd be different. And I bet you every time, you know, or you slam someone's head into the turnbuckle until they bust it open, and you put someone who's on normal bleeding. And I wouldn't be surprised if you did it 50 times and it would just be all over the place. Like, you wouldn't be able to tell, oh, it takes this many times to make someone bleed, because I bet sometimes they'll bleed on the first trial, they'll bleed on the 50th trial, the 27th, or the 10th, or the 15th. I always felt like it was random, making people bleed in these games. And that's part of the difficulty and tediousness. And that's what also made, you know, part of what made this run so long, is that I just felt like everything was against me in this run. As much as I tried to make it a speedy run and go through it as fast as I can with Pat Patterson, with the wrestler I never really played as, kind of backfired on me. But it's okay, because, you know, I feel like we've talked about a lot of great stuff in this episode. Got a little deep, got a little serious with Pat Patterson. Talking about, you know, the issues of being an openly gay athlete in the 60s, 70s, and even in today's era. It is a big deal for a lot of people. It shouldn't be a negative. I still stand by that. But, you know, you can feel how you feel. I just, you know, wish you wouldn't dislike someone just because of who they go to bed with. Just think of it this way, okay? If a guy's into another guy, that's one less guy you gotta worry about trying to steal the girl you want to go after. That's how I always viewed it. That's why I hung out with a lot of friends who were gay, because I knew if we were going out, if we were going to the club, or if we were going to a party, they weren't going to try to hit on the girls I was going to hit on. Because nothing's worse than going out to a party and seeing your friend pick up the girl that you wanted to pick up, and then you go home by yourself. So just think about it that way. That's how I always thought about it. You got to think positive. But yeah, Pat Patterson, getting to, you know, and again, No Mercy, with the exception of Andre the Giant and Brisco, there's not a lot, and maybe Jerry Lawler, if you will, there's not a lot of old school wrestlers in WWF No Mercy, so it was kind of refreshing to play as an old school wrestler. In Virtual Pro Wrestling too, I play as the old school wrestlers all the time. I'm always playing as like the legendary characters and stuff like that, because again, it was just, you know, those wrestlers in those games, they just fit that strong style, and it's different. I don't know, it feels different. Like, Pat Patterson would probably feel, I would feel much more comfortable playing as Pat Patterson in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, because I'll be going up against a lot more wrestlers who weren't as dynamic in their moveset, because again, that strong style, that classic style of wrestling, that very basic grappling-based wrestling, you know, just fits so much more. I don't know, I feel like when I play Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, I really am playing Japanese style matches, and when I try to play, oh look, Test busted open, I missed that, he busted open, great, but see, now he's coming at me, he's beating me up, and I can't have that going on. I need to get out of the cage, so here I go. So the strategy is make him tap out. Alright, this is what it was all for. This is why you weaken his leg, make him tap out. This is something they added in WWF No Mercy, where you can have someone get to that losing it meter, basically by making them tap out to a submission in a match where they can't actually give up. So like a cage match, you know, like a match where you take off submission. So or ladder matches too, is essential for climbing the ladder, making someone tap out if you want to win easily. But now I want to work him down, work his meter down, taunt as much as I can. I'm getting kind of flashy here, going for the unblockables, stomping on him, trying to check to see if I have a comeback special. Throughout all this time, I do not get a comeback special, which I thought was pretty amazing. That meant that I was playing pretty well, that I never put the computer in a position to say, hey, we should give him a comeback special because he's stinking up the joint. But here I go. Now my meter, I'm wearing him down, making sure his meter is as low as possible. And I'm going to give him one of his moves, I bet. Yep. See? Called it. I know how I'm going to play. Even I don't remember how this match went. I'm looking at it, I'm like, yeah, just give him his special now, because that'll give you the fastest time to go out there. I'm tapping. I'm probably exhausted by this point, so that's why I'm probably not even over yet. But tapping, there I go, over the top of the cage, and I still got... Oh, is this the last match? Oh, this is the last match. I thought this was the second to last match. I was wrong. Oh, thank goodness this is the second to last match. Hit some real American. Let's get Pat Patterson, the Intercontinental Champion, out. And I hope you enjoy this Let's Play. I am back. Hopefully, I won't be gone after this for another month. Hopefully, I won't go 1 month of posting videos and disappear for another month. I want to work all the way through from now into the end of summer. I want to hit SummerSlam because I missed WrestleMania. I want to hit the G1 Climax Tournament. I want to make up for last year's G1's Climax Tournament, taking the hiatus during that. But let me know what you think. I hope you like this video. If you stay to the end, thank you so much. Please like, comment, subscribe, all that jazz. My next video, I don't know what my next video is going to be, but it will be another Let's Play, hopefully in WWF No Mercy, WCW NW Revenge, Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. So until then, thank you for watching. And keep watching wrestling.